Oh, hello. Clearing up a massive oil spill that I caused because I didn't tighten up my oil filter properly, but we won't talk about that. Yes, we're here at the Practical Classics Workshop today. In fact, the whole team is here at the Practical Classics Workshop, which is quite unusual. Normally, it's just one of us down here, a couple of us down here, and the others are in the office making the magazine. But today, we're all here. So I thought, good opportunity to show you around a bit, show you some of the cars that we're working on, and introduce you to the team and what they're doing. So there's my Scimitar and Matt's Mini. We'll come back to those in a bit. We'll go outside and Alpha 147. Can't talk about that yet because you haven't seen it. There's a random van. Who put that there? James's Saab 900, Matt's TR6, Matt Tompkins, Boris Minor Traveller, random V6 XM, no idea what that's there. There's Clive over there in the corner working on the Golf, which is part of our Amazon project, which is why I'm wearing this t-shirt. James's Smart Roadster, a bit shiny, he loves a polish. And there's my Triumph 2000. So, you know, we'll have a chat with you, tell you what we're up to and the cars that we're playing with today, and yeah, hopefully you'll find it vaguely interesting. We'll start with the Triumph. Right, this is my Triumph 2000. And I know it's been in the magazine for quite some time, but it's probably my forever car. It's a car that I look after most, I suppose, in the magazine because of its status in my family. It's been family owned from new. My grandfather bought this car in 1972. He had a choice between this and a Rover P6. He loved the engineering in the P6, but the Triumph 2001, partly because the engine, he loved the straight six cylinder engine and the overdrive on the box as well, but also because it's just got a bit more space. And so this is a car he bought, and he owned it right the way through to when he died in 1994. My grandma drove it as well, and she took it on after he died, and then it went to my auntie, and then I think around 1998 the clutch went, and that's when my auntie put it in a barn. And when she put it in a barn, it stayed there. And it stayed there for 18 years. And after 18 years, it ended up looking like that. So I dragged it out of her barn. She agreed to let me have it and restore it and put it back on the road. And I spent 2 years restoring it. And at the end of that time, we had the car back again, the family car, the heirloom car, the car that will stay with us forever, or stay with me forever at least. So let's go inside. This is the place my granddad sat every day when he went to work, and he'd drive into Reading University every day in this and home again, and on the way in he'd smoke a pipe, and on the way back he'd smoke a pipe. And that's why the headlining here is stained brown. Not particularly pleasant to look at, but it's something I will never change. And on a hot day, when the doors have been shut for a while, you open them and you can smell the St. Bruno, which I love because it's my memory of my granddad. And memories in this space are what this car is all about. That back seat there is where I sat as a child, and it's my earliest memory of riding in any car. I was sitting in the back behind my grandparents going up to the Norfolk Broads to go sailing. So I'm extremely attached to this car. It's part of me, it's part of my life, and I'll never ever let it go. So that's my Triumph 2000. I'm gonna introduce you to some of the other guys. Let's have a look at them. Let's go and see Matt Tompkins. He can tell you about his Morris Minor.
Thanks, Danny. So, as Danny says, it's my Morris Minor. It's a 1969 Morris Minor Traveller in smoke grey. As you can see, I've not washed it. It's in a little bit of a sorry state at the moment, bless it, but it has just completed a run 1,800 miles to the south of France and back. I took my wife and my four-month-old daughter all the way down to the Ardèche region of France. It performed faultlessly, other than a coil failing on the auto route just outside Calais, which was unfortunate, but I put a good quality spare on and I was soon on my way. The car's pretty much standard. I rebuilt the 1098cc A-series engine just before we went on holiday. I took it out to repair a couple of leaking seals. I didn't want to do it in situ because it was a miserable task on the driveway, so I pulled the engine out. I had the front of the car off anyway to replace the grille and the bumper, just to give the front end a bit of a spruce up. And took the engine out, turned it over on an engine stand, put a new set of bottom end bearings in there, new oil pump, new duplex timing chain, and we were away. The engine, as I say, standard. It's got disc brakes up front. We've got the Marina conversion on there, which is an upgrade available for the Minor, which retains the original 4-inch PCD. And we've also got the Morris Minor van wheels. So they're about an inch and a half wider. So they're 4.5J rather than the standard 3J of the standard car wheels. I actually bought this car about 10 years ago. I was at a brass band competition of all places, and I'd had rather too many to drink. We were drowning our sorrows, having not won, let's say. And I was chatting to our soprano cornet player, and he said he'd got a Morris Minor in his in a garage, and that he'd taken it apart, ready for restoration. So it was a large Sprinter van and trailer to get the car back to my parents' house, wherein I started the restoration. Bought a brand new wood kit, which my late grandpa helped me rub down and finish in this Sick and Seatol light oak colour. It needs rubbing down and topping up actually now. It's seen some fairly heavy use, and I do use the car all year round. Essentially ended up putting a whole new underside in, all new wood, complete bare metal respray, underside, inside, outside, all in body colour. And then that got spotted by a certain Danny Hopkins when I was featuring it on Facebook. And Danny spotted it and asked, can we do a restoration feature on the car for a little car magazine called Practical Classics? It got featured in the magazine. It was at the NEC that November, and then in March at the Practical Classics Classic Car and Restoration Show, the car won me Restorer of the Year. And from there, I came into the magazine, having just finished university on some work experience, started freelancing, and then soon became a member of the team. So this car really is what started it all for me. Anyway, I think Matt George is around here somewhere to have a word about his TR6.
Thanks, Matt. Yeah, it's summer and the TR6 is out, although to be honest, I do like to try and use it all year round as much as possible. I've owned this car since 2017. I've always been into TRs. My dad's got a TR6. He's had it since I was a kid, so that's kind of where it came from. Like I say, bought it 2017. It had just been re-imported back from America. It's an American car, so left-hand drive. It had been sat in a barn in Ohio for 32 years before then, and was in need of a full restoration, and that's what we did over a two-year period. Obviously everything underneath needed doing, brakes, suspension, all the rubber parts. Did all of that and then rebuilt the engine. Body was painted, making it sound easier than it was. But we finished it off on stage at the Practical Classics Restoration Show at the NEC in 2019. Went fairly well, not too many issues along the way. But it was back on the road, first time in 34 years, so that was pretty nice. The thing I love about this car really is the sound, such a big part of it. The 2.5 litre straight six engine just sounds glorious when you're out on the road and you're motoring along, shall we say. Wind in your hair, again, it's a bit of a cliche, but it's kind of hard to beat really as you're powering along a nice A road, enjoying the view, enjoying the scenery, and you get the smell of the car, obviously the smell of the great outdoors, it's pretty good, really. Let's go and talk to James and his smart roadster.
Thanks, Matt. This is my smart roadster, 2004, so it's barely 20 years old. It's a lot more modern than the cars you've seen so far. But it's part of the family, it's part of my family, it's part of my fleet. It joins cars like the Citroën 2CV that you may have seen in the magazine in the last sort of couple of years. Last year particularly, when it got squished on its way back from France and got repaired at the NEC and put back on the road. I've left that at home today because that's had quite a lot of publicity lately. So I thought I'd bring the Roadster today to show you, just because it's just a little bit different. They didn't build very many of these. It was based on the original egg-shaped smart car, they sort of stretched the platform and did a lot of other stuff to it to make it a bit sportier. It's a sort of a parts bin special car, so it uses bits of the original smart for cost reasons, but it's also sort of like, I suppose, a frog eye sprite in that respect, because it's got all the bits from the parts bin, but it's low, cheap to run, and quite sporty. It's got a 700cc engine and a little boot in the back here, a boot in the front. The Smart is a big deal for me because it's been like a best mate for years, for 18 years of my life. It's been with me all over Europe on various trips. I've done the Stelvio Pass, been to the Monaco Grand Prix a few times and done the track. It's been over the Alps to Italy. So it really is a car that I just will never, ever, ever tire of. Of
Of course, I still love Citroens, and I don't know who this XM belongs to, this lovely XM V6, but I've got my eye on that. But this is the thing, we've all got our eye on projects. I've got the Saab is the next big one for me, the Saab 900, which you may have seen in the background. The idea is to get that car back on the road in time for our winter warmers trip this year in Practical Classics. So keep an eye out for that and loads of other stuff. We'll give you another tour of the workshop sometime soon when we'll bring a bunch of other cars for you to see.